Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is July 30th, 2017. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Telephone number is 937-323-7508. Daycare and preschool is accepting applications. Their telephone number is 937-325-4311.
Good morning.
Good morning,
and welcome to our worship service this morning. And we give a special welcome to our visitors. If you're new in the Springfield, County area, or looking for a new church home, invite you to make St. John your new church home. We have something different this morning, out of the ordinary. Our secretary ended up having to be in the hospital this week and have a procedure done. And so she only had Friday to do the bulletin, so instead of making two bulletins like normal, the driving bulletin and then the 10:30 service, she could only make the driving bulletin. So what you have for this morning is the service we use at the drive-in. So everything is in your bulletin. You will not need your red handle for anything. Things for you to make. Well, a note of the welcome. There's nothing there for you to repeat. It's just words that I will be saying. The prayer is the prayer of the day on the top of the insert for the readings for today. Also, because we are here in church and not at the drive-in, we will sing the psalm between the first and second lesson. So there will be that break between between the readings of the lesson. We will sing the song between lessons 1 and 2. That he graciously agreed to lead the song. So we will do that. The rest of the service follows just as you see it. So at this time, I invite those who can do so without difficulty to please stand as we begin by singing one of America's favorite hymns, Amazing Grace, which is page 3 in your book.
Opening hymn is Amazing Grace. Is written by a slave owner who converted to Christianity and helped to stamp out slavery. Amazing Grace, it saved him, and Amazing Grace can save us.
Oh,
We welcome you in the name of God the Father who has created us, God the Son who has redeemed us, and God the Holy Spirit who sanctifies and keeps us in the true faith. Amen. Let us pray together the prayer of the day that is printed on the top of today's reading insert in your book. Let us pray. Beloved and sovereign God, through the death and resurrection of your Son, you bring us into your kingdom of justice and mercy. By your Spirit, give us your wisdom, that we may treasure the life that comes from Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated as we listen to the reading of
Connie Singleton will be doing the readings.
Good morning. First reading is from 1 Kings, 3rd chapter. At Gibeon, the Lord appeared to Solomon in a dream by night, and God said, "Ask what I should give you." And Solomon said, "You have shown great and steadfast love to your servant, my father David, because he walked before you in faithfulness, in righteousness, and in uprightness of heart toward you. And you have kept for him the great and steadfast love, and have given him a son to sit on his throne today. And now, O Lord my God, you have made your servant king in place of my father David. Although I am only a little child, I do not know how to go out or come in. And your servant is in the midst of the people whom you have chosen, a great people, so numerous they cannot be numbered or counted. Give your servant, therefore, an understanding mind to govern your people, able to discern between good and evil. For who can govern this your great people?" It pleased the Lord that Solomon had asked this. God said to him, "Because you have asked this and have not asked for yourself long life or riches or for the life of your enemies, but have asked for yourself understanding to discern what is right, I now do according to your word. Indeed, I give you a wise and discerning mind. No one like you has been before you, and no one like you shall arise after you." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Image of his son, in order that he might be the firstborn with a If God is for us, who is against us? He who did not withhold his own son, but gave him up for all of us, will he not with him also give us everything else? Who will bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? It is Christ Jesus who died, yes, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all day long. We are accounted as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Those who can without difficulty, please stand for the reading of the Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 13th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord.
Our pastor, Pastor John Pollock, is now reading the Gospel.
Jesus, the parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed that someone took and sowed in his field. It is the smallest of all the seeds, but when it is grown, it is the greatest of shrubs and becomes a tree, so when the birds of the air come and make nests in its branches. He told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like yeast that a woman took and mixed in with 3 measures of flour until all of it was leavened. The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which someone found and hid. Then in his joy he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls. On finding one pearl of great value, he went and sold all that he had and bought it. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was thrown into the sea and caught fish of every kind. When it was full, they drew it ashore, sat down, and put the good into baskets, but throughout the bad. So it will be at the end of the age. The angels will come out and separate the evil from the righteous and throw them into the furnace of fire, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Have you understood all this? They answered, yes. And Jesus said to them, therefore, every scribe who has been trained for the kingdom of heaven is like the master of the household who brings out of his treasure what is new and what is old. The gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
You may be seated. A couple of announcements to share with you. First of all, thanks for everyone who donated food for our Christmas in July. Between the two services, we collected over 250 pounds of food and a $100 donation. Of course, then we had the pantry on Wednesday, and some 60 families or more were there, which amounted to 251 people. So that food didn't last very long. But again, your thanks for donating that food. Also, thanks to everyone who worked the booth at the fair and took the time to push little jobs at the county fair. And remember, the picnic is August 13th, second Sunday in August. There are still sign-up sheets, I believe, in the back, or you can call the church office and request what you are going to bring. Let us now sing My Faith Looks Up to Thee, page 4, in your worship.
Familiar gospel hymn written in the 1800s by Ray Palmer. Music written by Lowell Mason. My faith looks up to thee.
Save your people.
We believe that God is the author of all life in heaven and on earth. We believe that Jesus Christ is the Lord of life. He died on the cross to defeat the power of death and was raised again to bring resurrection and life to all who trust in him. He lives and rules among us now and for all eternity. We believe the Spirit of God is alive among us, daily giving us new birth, filling us with grace and truth, and bringing us into one life with each other. In harmony with the whole creation, we praise God for life. You may be seated as I ask that you give your attention to Becky this morning as she is going to sing Angel Band, which is one of my favorites. I'm hesitant to call it Southern Gospel or Bluegrass. I think it's more identified as Bluegrass Gospel because the only people I've heard sing it are Bluegrass. Please listen as Becky sings Angel Band.
Question one was basically the introduction. Well, yesterday,
practicing the sermon, I decided to change the introduction. And so question one doesn't come until after the new introduction. So in order that you'll know when to start paying attention to each of the questions, in order to fill them in, I'm going to give you question one so you can, when you hear the words, you know where into the note. So question one should read: the 28th verse of Romans tells us about the nature of God and about our situation in life in relationship to God. So the answer is our nature, situation, and relationship. So grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. During the early 70s, I heard the lyrics to a song that comes to us from the African-American Christian tradition, which had meaning to what we would be discussing today. And those lyrics went like this: as long as I have shoes to put on my feet and food for my children to eat, everything is going to be all right. It's going to be all right. Everything is going to be all right. As long as I have a place for my mother, a place for my sisters and brothers, everything is going to be all right. Everything is going to be all right. It's going to be all right. Everything is going to be all right. I share these lyrics with you because these lyrics basically express the hope and confidence of Romans 8, verse 28, which is one of the most meaningful verses in all the New Testament. But unfortunately, oftentimes it is overlooked because people like to center on the first part of Romans, in which Paul makes that excellent explanation of the gospel of salvation by grace through faith. And we all know that it is reading those first chapters of Romans that ignited Luther's further study into Scripture and the realization that we are justified by faith. So sometimes verse 28 is overlooked, even though it is one of the most meaningful verses and teaches us some very important lessons. This verse, question one, tells us about the nature of God and about our situation in life in relationship to God. We often hear this verse quoted by people. It is a verse that gives us hope in times of trouble, assurance in times of grief, and confidence in times of difficulty. Again, here's St. Paul as he says, verse 28 of our second lesson, the 8th chapter of Romans, and we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good for those who are called according to his purpose. Again, listen to these words and notice the qualifier and notice the confidence. And we know, without a doubt, that for those who love God, that's an important phrase to underline, for those who love God, all things work together for good for those who are called according to his purpose. So St. Paul is telling us in this verse that everything is going to be all right, no matter what we face in life. That everything is going to be all right because, first of all, God works for the good. God works for our good. The word good means literally what is useful, what is beneficial to someone, or what is profitable. Profitable not in the economic sense, profitable in the spiritual sense. So God works for our good. Now you contrast this with some of the religions of the world where it seems that God does not work for their good, he either gods painted totally different than the gods of the world. We see a God who works for us, a God who is on our side, and therefore we should be on his side. God desires our welfare at all times. All times, God desires our welfare. If there's one phrase I wish could be torn out of the English language, it is that phrase, "Oh, it was God's will." A contractor is contracted to make an addition on an elementary school. To make a bigger profit, he uses a lesser grade concrete. After the school is open for several weeks, the new building collapses, killing and injuring children, teachers, and aides. You hear at many of the viewings people going through and saying, "It was God's will." Now think about if you're a parent who has just lost a third grader, first grader, second, and this person comes to you who you know and who is a classmate of your child, and they say, "Oh, it was God's will." Well, my response would be, "Well, why is it God's will that your child live and not die?" It's God didn't work that way. God works for it. It is the contractor who is at fault. It was the contractor who listened to the devil to break the rules and use cheap concrete that caused that tragedy. The young father that works himself to death because he wants to have a vice president on the outside of his door by the time he's 40 and drops dead of a heart attack at 39 and a half. And people going through the line, "Is God's will?" What God's will? God tells us to take time off. God tells us that we need rest. It was that young man's fault. His priority was to be a vice president, not his family and his relationship with God. So God desires our welfare at all times. That is why he gave us the Ten Commandments. My Old Testament professor, Dr. Frank Zeilhammer, may he rest in peace, used to describe the Ten Commandments as loving leads for living. Loving leads for living. He even made a tape series on that back when VCRs, videotape was the end thing. He made a whole series on the Ten Commandments entitled just that, Loving Leads for Living. And it was the idea that God, knowing because of the fall that sin was in the world and how we would act without any controls on ourselves, that there would be anarchy. So he gives us these commandments so that we will know how to live together in community where everyone can enjoy all that God has created and given us. And so when a community puts God first, when it doesn't use his name in vain, when it remembers the Sabbath day to keep it holy, when it honors fathers and mothers and those in authority, when it doesn't murder, when it doesn't commit adultery, when it doesn't steal, when it doesn't bear false witness, when it doesn't covet those things of the neighbor, then society works well. And we live in harmony with one another. God wasn't trying to squeeze the juice out of living, as the critics say in the Ten Commandments. He was trying to enable us to live life to its fullest and enjoy the most juice out of living, without trampling on our neighbor or our neighbor trampling on us. God desires our welfare. That is why through our Lord Jesus Christ, he gave us the Sermon on the Mount. And through the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus raised up the Ten Commandments to make us realize it wasn't just acts that God was talking about, but also thoughts. And how thoughts in our mind can be as damaging as doing an action itself. And it is because God cares about our welfare that he sent our Lord Jesus Christ. So that we would not have to try to earn salvation. That we would not have to worry about whether or not we've done enough ritual, done enough tradition, done enough things. But that instead salvation was a free gift through grace by faith in Jesus Christ. Faith in his death upon the cross that had paid the debt of sin and guilt, that his rising on that third day from the dead gave us victory over death, and that ascension 40 days later, where he waits to come again to judge the living and the dead, assures us he truly was the Messiah, the Anointed One, the Son of God, the Savior and Lord of the world. All of this because God works for good. Because God desires our welfare at all times. He is a God who knows our condition and cares what happens to us. Again, compare that with the gods as they're portrayed in many of the religions of the world. You will not see a God who cares for you. You will not see a God who cares what happens to you. You will see a God or gods and goddesses who are indifferent. You could care less. If you make it to paradise, fine. If you don't make it, who cares? But that's not our God. That's not our Lord Jesus Christ. God couldn't make salvation any simpler. Believe in my Son, and you have salvation. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, so that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent the Son into the world, not to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. That's the type of God we have. A God who works for our good. Some of you may remember Senator from Georgia back in the late 90s, early 2000s, a veteran of the Vietnam War, Captain Max Cleveland. In the Vietnam War, he lost both his legs below the knee and lost his right hand. Well, he was elected senator from Georgia after saying none retired. And a group of senators have a Bible study. And so one day, Senator Cleveland went to the Bible study and he seemed withdrawn and tired. And one of his fellow senators asked him, said, "Max, sir, are you all right?" To which Senator Cleveland replied, "Not really. I've been having the same dream for 30 years. I accidentally dropped that grenade and I leap on it and it explodes and blows my legs off." That night, the study group gathered around Senator Cleveland and prayed that the Lord would heal that memory. 2 days later, the History Channel had a program on the incident of Senator Cleveland in Vietnam. The next day, a man from Annapolis called up Senator Cleveland. And he said to him, "Senator, you have the story wrong. That wasn't your grenade. It was a young recruit behind you who had opened the pins of his grenades before jumping out of the helicopter. One of them popped off his black vest and rolled on the ground. You leaped on it to save us all. I wrapped you up myself and got you to the hospital. I was on the helicopter. I know how it happened." Senator Cleveland came to the next Bible study and sang. A gigantic load had been lifted off his shoulders. Interestingly enough, the study group had been studying Romans 8:28. "For all things work for good for those who love the Lord." Senator Cleveland, after that experience, would go around racing in his wheelchair down the hall and say to the Senate chaplain or the fellow senators, quote, "Remember, things don't work out. God works out things." See, things don't work out. God works out things. Why? Because God works for our good. Because God wants us to be his people and to be a happy people, to be a loved people, to be a caring people. One theologian said, quote, "When adversity is ready to strike, God is ready to strengthen." You might want to write that down for future reference. Quote, "When adversity is ready to strike, God is ready to strengthen. God is ready to strengthen you. Because God works for the good. So everything is going to be all right. We can trust in these words of verse 28 because not only does God work for the good, but he works for the good in everything. Again, here's St. Paul as he says, and we know that for those who love God, all things or everything work together for good for those who are called according to his purpose. God works in every avenue of our life. What St. Paul is telling us is there is an overruling providence that turns our failures, our sorrows, and our disappointments into our good. That phrase, all things or everything, depending on your translation of the Bible, the word means all. It means the whole. It means all things. So St. Paul is telling us there's not an area of life that God through Christ does not work in. And that there is not an area in life where God is not working for that thing to be come out good. At the time it may not seem like good, but in the end, it becomes good. In the 50s and 60s, Harvard University had a preaching professor by the name of Dr. Gardner Taylor. Dr. Taylor was also the pastor of a large church in New York City. And so he would come down several days a week and give his lectures and preaching class and then go back to New York City to pastor his parish. And one of the things that made him popular was that when making points about preaching, he would usually always bring up a story about himself when he was in different situations, depending on what he was talking about in preaching that day. And so one story he told was that when he was a young preacher just starting out, he was sitting down to Louisiana during the Depression to preach at an evening service at a rural black church. Electricity had just been introduced into the area, and so this church had one light bulb that hung from a cord in the middle of the church, and that one light bulb lit the church for everybody to worship. So it came time for Dr. Taylor to preach, and he was preaching away and was on a roll, and suddenly the light bulb went out. Now remember, he was a young preacher. He didn't know what to do. He hadn't preached enough to be able to keep going and not have to need his notes anymore. So he stumbled around and tried to get back on track, and suddenly became silent. And during the silence, suddenly from the back of the church, an old man was shouting out, "Preach on, preacher! We can still see Jesus in the dark." Sometimes that's the only time we can see Jesus is in the dark. But the good news of the gospel is that whether or not we can see him in the dark, he can see us, because God works for the good in everything. Even in that situation, a preacher having no light, not being able to see his notes, God turned it for the good as he learned to be able to handle situations like that. And so, God works in everything. A theologian has said, quote, "The difficulties of life are intended to make us better, not bitter," end quote. It's another phrase to write down. It's one I'm having a hard time dealing with, because I've had some things, difficulties in life, and I'm really fighting hard not to be bitter and trying to be better. So the difficulties of life are intended to make us better, not bitter. Because God is involved in everything. And so those experiences, those difficulties, he turns into the good. And we have confidence in these words that everything is going to be all right, because it is promised to us that it happens for those who love God. And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to His purpose. This is not the experience of all people. It's only the experience of those who love God. Those who do not love God resist His love and go their own way. They either try to find salvation on their own, make up some way, or they deny the existence of God altogether. And when they suddenly leave this earth, are they in for a big surprise when suddenly they're standing before the one that he claimed did not exist? He goes, "Hi, I'm real." That's what happens to those who deny the love of God. So that those who love God see all things work for the good. The word love in this case is the word translated to mean to find joy in relationship with God. So for those who find joy in relationship with God, these benefits happen. What is that joy in relationship with God? Believing in Jesus Christ. The joy of knowing we don't have to earn salvation. The joy of knowing that our sins are forgiven. The joy of knowing that we have a mansion prepared for us by Jesus Christ Himself. The joy of knowing, as St. Paul will say at the end of chapter 8, that nothing can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. The joy of knowing that salvation is ours not because of what we do, but because of what Jesus has done. That is a joy that comes to us in that relationship with God. And because of that, all things work for the good. The word call, you said called to the purpose. That word means conforming to God's saving purpose. Or it means to be a saint. Called or conforming to God's saving purpose, which is faith in the death, resurrection, ascension, and return of Jesus Christ. When I say it means the same, it means same in the way that St. Paul uses it and the other apostles in their letters, meaning simply a believer in Jesus Christ. We're not talking about the church's usage of it, where the church restricts it to certain individuals that they say should be honored because of what they did for the Christian faith, like St. Peter and Paul, James and John, Andrew and Thomas, Mary, the mother of our Lord, Mary Magdalene, and so forth. No, saint here simply means you and me, every other believer in Jesus Christ. And so we are called, we conform ourselves to God's saving purpose by believing in His Son, Jesus Christ. And that makes us part of the community of faith. The word purpose means to set forth salvation. It means God's good pleasure. It means God's good intention. God's purpose from the beginning, after kicking Adam and Eve out of paradise, His purpose was still to have a relationship with His creation and to have people be saved, to have people enjoy salvation. But along the way, as you trace salvation history, you see the bumps and miscues and failures until God sends our Lord Jesus Christ. And then everything is made clear. So we serve the purpose of God in that we follow His good pleasure, His good purpose, and believing in salvation is through His Son Jesus Christ. Again, quoting an anonymous theologian, quote, "God takes heed of our every need. God takes heed of our every need." End of quote. In other words, God knows what we need before we even ask. God knows what we need even if we never ask. he can substitute something better because he knows something is better than what you're seeing, and you can't see beyond, you know, the old saying, when you're up to your armpits and alligators, you forgot your purpose was to drain the swamp. But sometimes we pray like that. We don't really see beyond the immediate problem. So God substitutes something else. Sometimes God says, wait. That if I give what you're praying for right now, it'll mess things up. It'll mess my plans up for you. And then sometimes God simply says, no. Because what we are asking for is not any best for us or for our family or those we know. So God takes heed of our every need, all because we love Him and He loves us, and He wants to do what is best for us. So no matter the situation, trust Him and our Lord Jesus Christ, everything is going to be all right. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. As we sing, My Life Flows On in Endless Song, page 5 in your bulletin, the offering will be collected.
This hymn was written by Robert Lowry, the Baptist minister from Pennsylvania. He wrote a lot of wonderful hymns. This is a happy hymn. It expresses that everything is going to be all right. My Heart Flows On with Endless Song, Robert Lowry, Baptist minister from Pennsylvania, wrote this hymn, and he has inspired many people, Robert Lowry.
Thank you.
whole people of God, let us join in prayer for the church, those in need, and all of God's creation. Our response today is, hear our prayer. Like the woman leavening flour, take your people and send us into the world as yeast, bringing life through the power of the risen Christ. God of mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give the leaders of the world a spirit of humility and a passion for truth and justice. God of mercy,
hear our prayer.
Reveal yourself to those who are searching for genuine treasure, and help us lead others to the gifts of word and sacrament that nourish us so richly. God of mercy,
hear our prayer.
Like the mustard seed that grows into a tiring plant, may love and faith grow within all those who are in need of comfort and healing. God of mercy,
hear our prayer.
We give you thanks for the gift of music and for artists who serve your church and give a glimpse of your glory in all the world. Unite us with Bach, Handel, and Schultz, with music makers of every land and culture, and with all the saints and angels in an everlasting hymn of praise. God of mercy,
hear our prayer.
O God, give us faith to trust your promises, that our lives may glorify your name, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who has taught us to say when we pray,
Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. May the love of the Lord Jesus draw us. May the power of the Lord Jesus strengthen us in his service. May the joy of the Lord Jesus fill our souls. And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon us and remain with us always. Amen. We conclude our worship with How Firm a Foundation, page 6 in your book.
This is another Baptist hymn. It's written by a Baptist minister who was a minister of a church in England. He was a minister for 63 years. His ministry began in 1775. He was born in 1751. How Firm a Foundation. He was a minister in Bristol, England. This is July the 30th, 8th Sunday after Pentecost, St. John's Lutheran Church. We're singing How Firm a Foundation, because we trust in God. We know everything will be all right, just as ministers through the centuries have known that.
Thank you.
thank you for watching us on YouTube. Share this with your friends, evangelize others, spread the word, spread the gospel. We thank you for worshiping. This is St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio, corner of Wittenberg and Columbia. We're opening a daycare here. We invite you to call the church office. We provide daycare, and this is an opportunity to spread the gospel to children that may be their only opportunity to hear God's grace, God's love, how God will be with us till the end of the world, and we have eternal life through Him. We are thankful for the flowers today. You can see the flowers on the altar. Beautiful flowers were given by Vicki and Larry Perks in honor of their wedding anniversary. Happy wedding anniversary, Vicki and Larry Perks. That's the drive-in flowers, the sanctuary flowers, Pastor and Gina, in honor of all the workers in God's vineyards. We were happy for all the people who stopped Clark County Fair at our booth. We hope that many of them will enroll their children in daycare. We have daycare here. We have our service at 8 o'clock at the Melody Cruise Inn drive-in. The last service will be Labor Day weekend. Please bring your pets. We'll have the blessing of the pets. 8 o'clock, Melody Cruise Inn drive-in, Route 40. We invite you to come worship with us. Worship as you are in your car. We have free coffee and donuts. We want to spread the gospel. We'll do what we can. We give out crosses. We pray for you. Come to our church. We'll feed you. We'll clothe you. We'll do everything that God asks us to do for you. And if you want to come and help do God's will, call the church office. We have plenty of things to do. Work for the night is coming. We are going to be all right, as Pastor Pollock said. Have faith in God. God will be with us forever and ever. We thank you for worshiping with us. It's the 30th of July, and this is 8th Sunday after Pentecost. We invite you to come worship in our sanctuary, 10:30 service every Sunday. 8 o'clock service will be from Memorial Day through Labor Day at the Melody Cruise Inn drive-in. So you have all sorts of opportunities to praise God, to know God through His Word, through service to others, through faith, through belief, through taking the sacraments. All these things God offers us. He will be with us always, even until the end of the age. We have eternal life through Him. We take communion. We pray for all others. We pray for God's love. We pray that we be filled with God's love and spread it to all the world.